Higher gossip is the kind of conversation that is at once titillating and illuminating.
In our own thinking about ourselves and the world, when I say we, modern people, we constantly have to confront the claims of science. So confronting the claims of science is confronting yourself, because it's confronting what the relation is and what the status is of the various ways we have of thinking about the things that really matter to us. The sciences also study human thinking and human feeling. Does this mean that it takes the place of philosophy? Does it even take the place of religion? There's a big part of the modern world that thinks that science is the only serious way to think about the world. Once you say that, then you have to attribute a certain kind of unseriousness to music, literature, and art, like they only deal with the emotions or something. Very few of us want to claim that. And so that way of thinking seems to me a way of avoiding a huge opportunity. And it's an opportunity that I think St. John's has embraced more than anybody. The way we do it here is we take the reductionist attitude as one of the attitudes to be examined, not to be taken for granted. Not to be disparaged, but to be examined and to try to see what it's worth. We feel that way about everything we study. In other words, we don't become Platonists. We read it because we think it might help us in our own thinking. I think it has a lot to do with that we're the object of our learning and studying who we are and what we are. So it necessarily involves the moral, and it involves fulfilling your destiny as a social being without losing yourself. That's one of the things that we confront. I think we confronted with our students initially. Becoming the member of a seminar is something you have to learn to do. You don't do it naturally. You begin with your attention being on your own opinions or with your fears or whatever. And it takes an enormous amount of work to become a group where the members can learn from one another. It doesn't just happen automatically. And I think that combines the moral and the intellectual. I was born in Peabody, Massachusetts. It's pronounced Peabody, not Peabody. And my parents were ethnically Greek immigrants. My mother from Greece, my father from Istanbul, then Constantinople. My grandfather lived with us for a long time. And on weekends, we would run up to his bed and we would jump in bed with him. And he would start telling us stories. Well, it was only as I became an adult that I realized what the stories were. They were a mixture of him growing up in Lesbos, the Greek War of Independence in 1821, and Greek mythology at the same time. So I thought my grandfather was a contemporary of Hercules. I thought it was like he was one of his friends. So he would tell him the stories, you know, like the labors of Hercules. But I thought he was just, my grandfather was there too, you know, kind of hanging around. And the same thing with the War of Independence. So I had a lot of stories, but none of them with any historical context, which I think was a great benefit. They were all present to me, you know. Nothing was of the past. It was only later that I learned that there were, you know, maybe a couple thousand years difference between them. My mother tells me that when I went to the first grade, I spoke no English. I think that's highly unlikely, but my mother had a tendency to exaggerate things. I suspect what was the case is that I spoke English as a second language and not very well, and was still primarily a Greek speaker. I'm pretty sure that I self-identified as a Greek. It was only later that I learned that I really wasn't a Greek, but was a Greek American. The neighborhood I grew up in, I would say in the four or five blocks around my family's house, 80% Greeks. Greek Orthodox Church, half a block down the street. There was a union of religion and community. In fact, I grew up thinking that there was no difference between the two. To be Greek was to be Orthodox. To be Orthodox was to be Greek. We were considered Greeks by other Americans, but then, of course, the Irish in the neighborhood, we thought of as Irish, the Italians as Italian, the Jews as Jews. So we were divided up into more or less friendly clans. Your relation to your parents, I think, was different. On holidays, we would kneel in front of our father and kiss his hand and thank him, like at Easter. That sounds strange to you? That was like a common thing. And when I found out that other kids didn't do it, I just didn't know what to think. At the time, it was just life. You know, I didn't know that anything else existed. My parents, their goal was that we would retain the traditions, and especially the language, but that we would become Americans. I remember my father, what he said was, our family will not be in the working classes for more than one generation. He expected us to be Americans. We were going to go to university. We were going to be in the professions in one way or another. That was the family goal. For us, when we grew up, a hamburger was really exotic. We got them a couple of times a year when we went to the beach. Hamburgers, hot dogs, but not any other time. I remember when we got older and, you know, we had really realized how different we were. My brother Peter and I would joke and we would say to our mother, oh, Mom, not stuffed squid again. We were alive to ethnicity. And being an American for us was an important thing, but it was different from being Greek. Those were two different ways of being. The ethnicity was, it was connected with the family. It was something that in some way you were going to have to leave behind. And being an American was going to be your permanent state of things. I went to a public high school in a mill town. And so it wasn't like the greatest high school in the world. But I had two or three rather good teachers. And one of them taught biology, and she made it interesting and would assign us projects to do, like outdoor projects. And so it was the first experience I had of learning, which was not out of books, namely where you were finding out your own things. It was the sense that the door was open for me to think for myself. And so that got me really interested in science. At that age, it was empirical. It was the world and the things that were in it. I had a couple of friends who were interested in the same things, and we would go wandering in the woods near our home to looking for stuff, finding out about living things, started getting very interested. My mother wanted me to be a priest. But then, as she put it, she realized that I was so ill-tempered that I would just drive everybody out of the church. So they had to find me another profession. So I went to Bates. The first thing I noticed, the place was filled with Americans. That was our word for anybody who wasn't Greek or identifiably ethnic. They were Americans, and they were strange to me. And I was terribly homesick. The smells of the dining hall were just horrible. I couldn't stand them. So I spent a large number of months eating nothing but peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, apples, and cornflakes. And I would take them out of the dining hall and eat them outside. I don't know what would have happened to me, but I had roommates, so I had relations with them, and I rather ended up liking both of them. So life wasn't as horrible as it might have been, but I was terribly, terribly homesick. And it lasted until Thanksgiving vacation. Thanksgiving vacation, I took the bus down to Massachusetts, which was, you know, like 120 miles. But for me in those days, it was the other side of the world. So I went home for Thanksgiving, and I was so relieved to be home. And then after a day or so, I remembered what it was actually like living with my mother. I'm not telling you anything you don't know, I don't think, who was, you know, my mother, and therefore a demanding person that was hard to please. All of a sudden, I started thinking, I'm living in a place where my mother isn't. And I don't have to listen to her all the time. And I don't have to obey her at all. Why am I complaining? Why am I complaining about living someplace where I'm free of my mother? From that moment on, I stopped being homesick. Second semester, I realized that I was going to major in biology and chemistry. I was going to have a double major because I was interested in both of the things. At Bates, there was this program called Cultural Heritage. Now, Cultural Heritage was something like the St. John's Seminar contracted into 2 years, reading classical books and having discussions on them. I found myself really enjoying it. And there was one new teacher there, George Goldet, who ended up being, and I still think of him, the greatest teacher I've ever seen, ever. And that still feels true to me. He had this way asking you the most provocative and uncomfortable questions, but you didn't want him to stop asking them. And you realized that you were now experiencing thinking. And so that's when philosophy came in. It opened up this world of books where unbelievably interesting things were being said that had nothing to do directly with the sciences, but it really important and interesting things. And fortunately, I had a teacher who could bring them out. So now there was this battle between biology and chemistry on the one hand and philosophy on the other. In addition to that, there was an obligatory course at Bates that everybody had to take, a year of Bible. It was a semester of Old Testament, a semester of New Testament, taught by two terrific teachers. So it opened up the Bible as a real book. It was not being presented directly as something to be revered, but as something really, really interesting to be understood. Those were the things that filled out my education in the sciences, a very great gift that Bates gave. And I heard that 4 or 5 years after I graduated, they got rid of that program. It was getting in the way of people taking enough courses in their majors. One of the first moments in which I saw a connection between my philosophical interests and my interest in the sciences was the work of Driesch and Spemann that raised the question of whether the activities of living things could be explained entirely in terms of physics and chemistry, or whether there was something intrinsic called life, called the living force. That was now becoming a real issue for me, namely how to think about the world, and whether even thinking itself was just the chemical process, or whatever that might mean. This was an actual philosophical question, but it involved itself deeply in how you understood the living things in front of you. While I was in graduate school, I had discovered this man, Hans Jonas, all on my own, and some other people connected with him who were continental philosophers, many of them students of Heidegger, who were thinking about the philosophy of the study of living things. And so his essays were like an eye-opener to me. This was actual philosophical thinking about living things. It was a question of how do you understand the evolution of life on Earth? Is that something that can itself be understood in ordinary ways, or did it also involve forces that were not chemical and physical forces, but there was a kind of inherent directionality to evolution? And then I started reading Aristotle's biological works, which were not the sort of things that people tended to read if you were interested in Aristotle's philosophy. You read the metaphysics, the ethics, and so on. When you've read Plato and Aristotle with some kind of seriousness, you start thinking of the world as a very deep and complex thing, and you're less likely to believe that some simple version of the atomic theory is going to explain everything. And so that was always with me. Thanks, cultural heritage again. I kept it pretty quiet because historians of science did the history of science, and they were not all that interested in continental philosophy. The philosophers that were current, the positivists that were current at the time, were also thinking about biology, but in very, very different, and I thought much less interesting ways. They were interested primarily in the logical structure of scientific theories and not in what the theories were about. They weren't primarily interested in how to think about living things, but in just analyzing logically the way biologists did their work. So I wrote a dissertation, which I never submitted. I came to St. John's and forgot about it, on a big book that Darwin wrote after The Origin of Species called Variation in Plants and Animals Under Domestication. What that book was about was how to understand the development of kinds among domesticated animals and plants and how that related to the evolution of things in nature. And then towards the end of it, he himself was getting more and more interested in theoretical questions of inheritance and genetics and wrote a couple of very important chapters. He was completely wrong in everything, but wrong in extremely interesting ways. He had decided there had to be a kind of atomism in animals and plants and living things, in the same way that there was an atomism in ordinary matter. And also like there was a kind of atomism in living things because all were governed by cells. Namely, all living things, you know, big living things were composed of cells. So he created this whole picture of genetic units, entities, almost like Mendel's genes, but behaving in very, very different ways from Mendel's. Almost all the ways that he imagined them behaving were ways in which they don't behave. But the fact that he raised the question in the way he did ended up being in some ways quite important. Okay, I'm in graduate school. I'm in my fifth year. Time for me to leave. So I was trying to think through what I was going to do with my life. So I decided I didn't want to be a scholar in the history and philosophy of science. I enjoyed studying it. I learned a lot that was important to me, but I didn't want to be a scholar in it. So I wasn't quite sure what to do. It would have been a great disappointment to my department and my major professor if I didn't go in that direction. Nevertheless, I really didn't want to go. And I was talking to my closest friend in graduate school, who also, this is one of those weird connections. He had been a student of the teacher that I told you about at Bates in cultural heritage. This guy, Dan, had been a student of this very same professor when he was at Harvard. Imagine that. And we bumped into one another in graduate school. As I was talking to Dan about this, I wasn't quite sure what to do. And I said, you know, I'm thinking of just getting a job at a private high school where I can teach biology and philosophy and coach basketball. It turned out that Dan, after he had graduated from college, had taught at St. John's for a couple of years and stayed for 2 or 3 years and decided he really wanted to go back to school. So Dan said, you know, if you go to St. John's where I was, you can teach philosophy and biology and play basketball. He had an old St. John's catalog. He said, yeah, why don't you read this, see if you're interested. I started reading it. I couldn't put it down. It was like every single thing I had ever thought about in my education that mattered to me was all contained in this project for a college. I just couldn't put it down. I read it through the night. I hadn't gone to sleep. And the next day, I wrote a letter to St. John's expressing a, you know, really deep interest in coming there. And it was all because of what I had learned from reading the catalog. It was the only place where it was not assumed that there was real distinction in kind between my interest in the sciences and my interest in philosophy and literature, that they were all somehow formed a unity as supposed to form a unity. Try to put it in the best language that I had. Anyway, so I sent the letter off thinking nothing would happen, but I sent it off anyway. 2 weeks later, I got a response from St. John saying, we found your letter very interesting. Why don't you come for an interview? Whoa. Didn't expect it. All I can remember about the visit is I spent the whole weekend in a kind of terror at how inadequate my education was, and that the undergraduates here were doing things that I had only imagined, but had never really done myself. I saw a seminar that was run by Jacob Klein on the sophist. The undergraduates essentially carried the whole discussion in this extraordinarily difficult dialogue. And I was like, is this really happening right in front of me? And the same thing, a junior math class where they were reading the Principia on their own, and the tutor was saying very few things. I thought it was extraordinary. I'm absolutely eye-opening and extraordinary. I was interviewed by the instruction committee, and I mentioned all this to them about how overwhelmed I was by this, and I just wasn't sure whether I could do it. You know, I just hadn't realized how different this was. In spite of the cultural heritage thing and the great teaching of my teacher, George, I had never seen anything like this in the sense of the undergraduates taking control of their own education with the guidance of a tutor. It was just, I don't know, just overwhelming. So just before I left, I was called into the dean's office for the final interview. I was chatting with John Kiefer, and he said, you'll be hearing from us sooner. Thank you very much. And he said, oh, by the way, would you be interested in knowing, you know, what your salary would be? And I said, yes. And he told me, and he must have seen the crestfallen look on my face. The dean said, does that seem low to you? And I said, well, perhaps a little bit. And he said, well, to me, it seems quite enough for an inchoate 26-year-old. I said, the only thing I could think of to say was, what does inchoate mean? I didn't know. I didn't know what the word inchoate meant. Then he told me what inchoate meant. And I thought to myself, well, you know, that's about right, you know, for me, inchoate. Yes, that's good. I went back, and 2 weeks later, I got an offer completely out of the blue and against all my expectations. And at one point, half thought of not taking it because I just didn't think I could do it. I wasn't sure that I could do it. For a long time, I was like one of the babies of the faculty because there was a preponderance of older people. They had just started hiring people to make up for the fact that a lot of people had moved to Santa Fe when the new college opened, and they were still just beginning to replenish the faculty. John Kiefer, Ford Brown, Richard Schofield, William Kyle Smith, they're the ones that I can remember who had been tutors at St. John's before it became St. John's. When Barham Buchanan came and revolutionized the school, they gave every faculty member here the option of staying on if they wanted to. Those four were still there. Klein had retired because in those days, you had to retire when you were 65, but he still taught part-time. He and his wife, Mrs. Klein, Dodo to everyone. In spite of the fact that they were not that young, they continued to have dinner parties once or twice a week, and they made a point of frequently inviting the newer members. It was just wonderful. The newer members of the faculty to come and have dinner with more senior members of the faculty and students. Nobody gave them any money to do it. Nobody paid for the food that they bought and made, but they thought it was absolutely essential that these relationships flourish outside the classroom. Even though I wasn't a particular, you know, friend of theirs, I think in my first few years there, I must have been a guest at their house 6 or 7 times. The conversation was almost entirely about what you were thinking of, not what he was thinking of. He almost never talked about what he was thinking of at these things. Both of them were just quite wonderful at bringing people out and making them feel at home. I had never before experienced a college that was actually a community. I didn't know, by the way, that that's what I was experiencing when I saw the seminar, the community in action in a class, but that the class was not the only way. It was in action. The other thing that was true of all the older tutors was that although they were extraordinarily learned in all sorts of things, they never made a point of it. That was not the main thing for them. The main thing is what happened when human beings got together to talk about serious things. Their attention was entirely on that. And their learning was their learning, you know. One of the first dinners I was at, he wanted to learn why he should take evolutionary theory seriously. It seemed to him that the theory of natural selection was just nonsense. Part of it, of course, clearly is to see what I've got. I came there as a guy who had studied these things. They wanted to see, you know, what they were getting. I had put it to them in a way that they didn't recognize. And I said that, in my opinion, the way you're getting it wrong is that you're thinking of biology as a theoretical science, like physics, which it's not. That kind of interest. What do you mean by that? I said, well, I think biology is entirely empirical. And what you think of as biological theory is biological speculation, acts of the imagination, when you're trying to imagine how to think about animals and plants in more comprehensive terms. The things that you're thinking of are not theories in the way that you use often in physics, where you make predictions of certain kinds. If you're thinking of natural selection as being a predictive theory, then obviously you're going to think that it's meaningless and trivial because it's not predictive of anything. It doesn't predict anything. All it does is guide your thinking. So it ended up being a kind of interesting conversation. By the way, I should say, I don't think I'm saying something either widely known or widely believed. This was what I came to through a lot of struggles in graduate school. when I was reading The Origin of Species really in detail with my major professor and a few other students, I said, this isn't physics. This is not anything like physics. This is history. And I was trying to develop that understanding of things that I had. Like history, it's completely empirical. And again, like history, everything beyond the empirical is speculation. It doesn't mean, by the way, that the speculation is empty or uninteresting, but it means it's speculation. It's a way of making a whole out of your empirical studies, but not in a way that yields specific predictions to which you can conduct specific experiments, which will tell you whether they're true or not. It's not like that. It's just not like that. If you're interested in evolutionary biology, then you're interested in things that have happened, not that are happening. In other words, the big question you want to say, how did the mammals come to be? That is a strange case of an empirical question to which there is no empirical answer because it's all gone. That is the sort of thing that evolutionary biology constantly deals with. And to try to make it into a theoretical science like physics is just to try to make it into something it cannot possibly be. The crucial thing for me when I'm thinking about evolutionary biology is to keep emphasizing that it's a purely empirical science in which you keep trying to make a whole out of your particular discoveries. One of the great tasks of the college was how to integrate the modern sciences into a program of education, which in other respects more or less followed the traditional liberal arts. When I came, because of my background, I was placed in the sophomore lab immediately and taught it without interruption for 7 straight years. One of the things that was true, not of all, but of some aspects of the lab program, and especially of biology at the time, was in some ways not very different from an ordinary biology course. There was nothing about it that was distinctively St. John's. Sophomore lab was extremely difficult to teach because it couldn't be taught very easily in a St. John's way, where the class was as an exploratory class with the students because it was very factual. It was the imparting of information about living things. Those first years were my attempt to struggle with that and see what we could do to change it. We started bringing in more and more Aristotle and other classical authors who spoke more expansively about these things. Also, we started reading Darwin, the beginning, a kind of reluctance to read Darwin in the sophomore lab because it wasn't appropriate to the period of time. Well, if you were going to do something appropriate to the period of time, you wouldn't do any science at all. You know, it gets into that kind of discussion. I also brought in some of those experiments in the development of sea urchins and frogs and the readings that go along with them, which were extremely interesting and are still with us. And then more speculative things about genetics, trying to do that and slowly reorganizing it. The college then decided that we were going to go from 4 years of laboratory to 3 years of laboratory. This was under Curtis Wilson's second deanship. It was very controversial. One of the reasons for doing it was that sophomores had, instead of having 4 classes, had 5. And so there was a feeling that short shrift was being given to things like music. The 3 years were divided up into some remnants of this thing called the theory of measurement in freshman year, along with a semester of studying living things. And then in the senior year, another semester of studying living things more modern. In a way, that worked better because you could have studying the animal as a whole and the animal in its environment in the freshman year, and then studying the animal more internally in the senior year when genetics and molecular biology and so forth had become prominent. Many, many other people were involved in continually trying to refine these things and make them more in tune with what we do at the college. And we've been struggling with that, I think, almost continuously for the whole life of the college. A great struggle. I mean, an enormous task. I don't think anybody else has taken it on. I don't think any other college has taken this task on seriously the way we have. Thank you. Curtis Wilson came to the college to be a dean just when I had gotten tenure. The joke that goes around the college, might even be true, is that the instruction committee said that you can only come back if you agree to lead the place. And he reluctantly agreed to be dean. He was dean of the college in the early 60s and then left to go to Santa Fe when the college in Santa Fe opened, and then decided he really wanted to go back to his research in the history of science. And he went and took a position at the University of San Diego for a number of years, then decided finally that he'd had enough of that and wanted to come back. For Klein, study of the sciences and mathematics was an essential part of this education, but Curtis knew more science from the inside than Klein did. So he was able to refine and deepen many of Mr. Klein's insights about the sciences. And he did it in a number of different ways. One of them was the additions that he made to the curriculum in the lab and in math. College decided that it wanted to study a certain thing. He would produce a manual for studying that thing, which contained relevant readings, relevant experiments, commentaries and stuff. He would just do this over and over again, like half a dozen manuals he's written, some of which are no longer in use, but still hanging around so people can learn from them. He also gave a number of lectures on the most interesting philosophical scientific topics that focused the community on these things, and also my own thinking. Curtis really, in a way, brought science in a much more firsthand way into the college. Things would happen, like a very important book written in Italian. All of a sudden, it would appear in English, having been translated by him. We didn't even know it was coming out. Or a very important book written in French would come out in English, having been translated by him, because he thought those of us who didn't read French well should read it. And the same thing with another book in German. Suddenly, you realized that he had real facility in all sorts of languages, and one never knew about it. He worried about everything. He worried about the college. He worried about making the right decisions about things. He took everything, every responsibility seriously. We talked a lot about political matters. Next to the sciences, we would talk more about political matters than almost anything else. He was very active in politics. Questions of citizenship and stuff mattered to him. We would talk a lot about current administrations, things we liked, things we didn't like, things that we were worried about the country. He was afraid of the emergence of certain rigid ideologies that didn't allow for the free exchange of ideas. And I think they were both on the left and the right, so didn't only go in one direction, but he was worried about the anger that was becoming more and more prevalent. Things we were becoming only in name citizens of the same country. It's very difficult to talk about Curtis without seeming to minimize him, because he was so modest and self-effacing and would never put himself forward. What intellectual integrity actually looks like, that's what I learned from him. And by intellectual integrity, I mean a commitment to tell the truth about things and to say it as carefully as you can and to work at it as hard as you can work at it. I can't overstate how much I admired him, and I could never live up to the standard for me that he set in that. Touchstones came up in the mid-80s, and it was the result, I think, almost entirely of the fortunate conjunction of a friendship between me, Howard Seideman, and Jeff Comber. And it was at a time when Jeff Comber was director of the Graduate Institute. Howard and I had gotten to know one another not long before that, maybe 4 or 5 years before that. He came from Santa Fe in 78, 79. I met him when I got back from sabbatical. Jeff, I had known. He was here before me at the college. He came in 65 and I came in 67. Howard and I had been talking a lot about the question of outreach from the college. We'd been talking about that in a kind of theoretical way. What can one do to bring what we have thought about education to be more widely present in the world? What would such a thing look like? At the same time, I think Jeff was thinking about how to help teachers who were anxious to use some of the insights they got from the college in their own classes. Jeff had gotten an invitation from a school district in Connecticut, in Hartford, to come and do some work with the teachers there and think about how they could introduce more cooperative learning discussion in their classes. He had brought Howard with him, and they went up and they did some things, some workshops and stuff. They came back, they were kind of excited, and Howard told Jeff that he had been speaking with me about similar things. So the next time they brought me with them, we knew immediately that whatever we did in secondary public schools could not be directly anything that was done at St. John's. But we also knew that in order to have a discussion which focused away from one's self, you needed a text. Otherwise, you would be mired in your own opinions. We started thinking that we would have to redo text in order to make him accessible to students with limited education, limited interest, limited attention, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What would be required to make accessible to the students of all kinds a kind of teaching and learning which would allow them to take control of their own learning and not simply be the recipients of information? We were getting more and more excited with the project and also at times more and more discouraged because it was so difficult and the circumstances under which teachers normally work are so difficult compared to the circumstances under which we work here that there's just no comparison. We kept producing more and more, and we were starting to think of having a separate organization, not connected with the college, that would do this. I mean, it began at the college, began through our reflections on our own teaching here, but it had to end up being something separate. And so Touchstones became the organization that fostered this. I'm almost positive Howard thought up the name Touchstones, meaning something which allows you to gauge the worthiness of something else. The touchstone is a stone whose purpose is to tell you whether something that you're rubbing up against it is pure gold or some imitation of gold. We began in public schools, mostly secondary. We expanded to primary school. Then we expanded to a project in prisons in Maryland, both the men's and women's prisons in Maryland, and also in organizations, not educational institutions, but, you know, commercial organizations that were interested in bringing forth new modes of leadership, which were not top-down, but involved the participation of people actively. In some ways, the things that I've seen done in prison were some of the most remarkable. We've got one project now in the women's prison where the women essentially run the class themselves. We come and to look and see, but what they can do is quite extraordinary. They can take control of their own learning. They can learn to cooperate with one another, a remarkable thing. Being human means finding your connection in the world with other beings like you, but that are not you. It involves finding yourself in this world. The redemption of your soul requires the presence of another human being. You can't do it yourself. When you try to do it yourself, you close yourself in into your own world. In communities, the members are both independent and also parts. They're really independent beings living their own lives, but they have somehow miraculously come together in a common purpose. I could never have done whatever little I've done in thinking about these things apart from the college. It would not have been possible for me. I required this community and this curriculum coming together. The curriculum by itself would have been of no use. And the community can only exist because it's centered around a common task. The emergence of the modern sciences has, in a way, completely altered our way of thinking about things and presented us with problems that will require a lot of thinking to think through. And also to say problems is not really right, because that makes it sound like something that you're going to solve. I would say questions that will become perennial questions for us, that we're going to have to take seriously. They're not going to be the kind of questions that we answer and then go on to something else. If you left the sciences out, then you would be ignoring a huge thing that makes us who we are. And makes us who we are, whether we ourselves have studied the sciences or not. My upbringing has shaped my soul in ways that are utterly precious to me, but that if you asked me to articulate exactly what, I couldn't do it. I would just say that it deepens everything else. We were imbued with our family, our traditions. So it was really a collection of these two things, all of that to remain with us while we became American. It helped me appreciate the differences among human beings and the similarities in the middle of the differences. It's difficult to articulate because it really doesn't have anything directly to do with the sciences, except in the following way, that precious things like this probably can't be explained by the sciences completely. They just can't, and it doesn't make them less. ¶¶